This is Babette Babich, and I teach philosophy at Fordham University, and I'm here in Fordham University and have the great pleasure of being able to be joined in conversation by, I'm going to go in alphabetical order, Joseph Cohen from Dublin, and Raphael Zagury-Orly, you're very much at the end, are you not, of the vowel, who comes to us from Israel, from Jerusalem, but actually right now in Heidelberg. So there's a whole international conglomeration at the table. We're going to have a conversation, a discussion over many things. I have a book here, which these two gentlemen edited, Cohen and Zagury-Orly, along with several other participants who held a conference at really your initiative at the Bibliothèque Nationale in Paris just a year ago. Let's see if we can have this very, very somber conference. Yes. Anyway, so that's Heidegger. So we're going to be talking about some of that. I wanted to say just a few words, but I also recommend, I very much recommend that people who are looking at this, Google this, particularly both of you are directors, professors, doctors. It's almost impossible to find an appropriate title to use. But Raphael Zagury-Orly was the head of the MFA program at Bezalel, which is an academy of fine arts and has many things and is also worth visiting, especially for Fordham students who are interested in maybe making an exchange year. One thing to keep in mind, also folks who are down at some of the other art schools in New York. In addition to philosophy, huge amounts of philosophy that you've worked on, have you not, especially Derrida? So it seems you have a real specialization in Derrida, at least in terms of the competencies of translation. I understand grammatology has come out, and I couldn't begin to think what that would be like in Hebrew.
In Hebrew, yes.
Just now. Wow. And some other works you've also translated, as well as Bataille into Andalus,
yes,
which is really challenging. So there are two of them. I don't know. But you go to only pick hard people, it seems to be. As well as a very lovely book that I am particularly fond of, this Questionner en cours, which is on Heidegger and questioning, which is, in addition to things that also makes it very hard to introduce the two of you, because you work together. So you do things, this is almost like the twins of ancient antiquity. So you do things together that's surprising. Not many people in philosophy work together, even though the ancients always said that was the thing, that you really needed a friend to, Alexander Nemas just wrote a book on friendship, but having a friend to really bounce things off of and to speak with, to have thinking and conversation is rare. And Joseph Cohen, who has actually too many books, but this is a scary thing. It's very, very hard to begin to list them, but I have to try. Just because there's two things, but the two of you, I immediately go to the next thing because of the contributions in Les Temps Modernes. So large, complete dedication. This is of course a journal, so think about that. This is a journal. Anyway, Les Temps Modernes, dedicated to Heidegger, and the question of place, lieu, is difficult to translate, but one could say place, situation, position, what have you, as well as on Derrida. And this is something that you did in the l'événement, very hard. I don't quite know, again, event of deconstruction, happening of deconstruction. That's a difficult thing. As well as, which I was surprised to not to have at the front of our thinking, because this is also a sign of thing, how things change, Levinas. So Levinas would have been maybe several years ago the thing we'd be talking about most. That's changed, which maybe we'll get to be talking a little bit about. And I just want to list the most recent, the L'Spectre Juif d'Hegel, which is the Jewish ghost.
Hegel's Jewish ghost.
Yes. That's very, that's a very, very strange thing. And Sacrifice, you also have that, as well as this essays on Levinas and a Husserl dictionary. So
in collaboration with Dermot Moran.
Dermot Moran. Let us not fail to mention Dermot Moran. This is very good. So we are happy to do that, as well as lots of other things. This other, in collaboration with Gerard Bensoussan, is Heidegger, the Danger and the Promise. So, and that was almost before some of this seems to have really happened. Yeah. So you kind of anticipated everything. So there's and then, because this is Fordham, mm-hmm. and this was published at Fordham University Press, with an English translation, Judaeté, Questions for Jacques Derrida, and can you say this for me in French?
Judaeté, oui? Questions pour Jacques Derrida.
Oui. C'est fantastique. C'est bon. Okay, so we have some things. And then, of course, that's also in a German translation, Judentümer, Fragen für Jacques Derrida. And that is really an interesting constellation, the questioning, the bringing of questions from Heidegger for Heidegger to Derrida. And Derrida is one of those who takes up questioning. Welcome to Fordham. I am very, very glad that you are here. How to begin? I have these books in front of me. I even have Travnie translated. All of Travnie's in a little pile. and next to Travnie, but it's taller, is this Heidegger et les Juifs. What made you want to do the most dangerous theme? I don't know who to ask first. This is a very dangerous theme, you know, to pick this up, of all things.
Yes, it's first of all, thank you so much for having us, Babette, and it's a true pleasure to be here, and especially to have this conversation with you. We've known each other for quite some time now, and we've been following. I think this is true for Joseph, and I've been following your work, and you participated in some of these events we have organized, and Joseph has organized also along the years, and most recently in this one here you've just mentioned, which is a publication after a pretty important, I think, colloquium, symposium in Paris at the Bibliothèque Nationale, which is very important to have it in such a central institution, I think, and it was very important for us to have it in a central public institution, this discussion on Heidegger and the Jews, Heidegger et les Juifs. Just maybe to start to say something, it's a sort of culmination of this question of the status of the Jews, the status of Jewishness, of Judaism in the history of philosophy. You see, Joseph and I, we met in Paris at the Sorbonne. Maybe I can tell very, very rapidly the story at a Professor Königson-Montin class on Hegel. We were both interested in mainly in German idealism. We both did our thesis on German idealism, Kant, Hegel, Fichte, Schelling. I did some work on Schelling. So it was a class on Hegel, and we didn't know each other. The first discussion I remember in this class was on Hegel. Very. This is how maybe Joseph, you want to tell the particular story of this meeting. I think that rapidly the question of this status of Judaism or the Jewish question in German idealism was very important for us to explore, to understand. Is it a simple rejection? Is it what we call anti-Semitism? Is it a something else? Is there something else? Is there something else to explore? What is it there that we can explore in this question? And for us, it has become immediately much before Heidegger, in German idealism, this has become a very central question.
And of course, it was all linked at the time. It was all linked to the relationship between Hegel and Levinas, right? Canonical relationship. How do you think Hegel's systematic philosophy and Levinas's attention, responsibility towards the other? And I remember, just to carry on the discussion of our meeting, I remember when we met, we had very heated debates on what is the place of the other in Hegel's philosophy? What is the place of the other? And of course, the other was always, in some manner, the Judaic figure, the Jewish figure, right? And that led us to read Levinas, who was not a popular author in Paris in the early 90s.
Really?
Nobody read Levinas at the university. Nobody taught Levinas at the university, for the exception of Catherine Chalier at Nanterre, and Derrida. Jacques Derrida all did his seminar at the École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales. We were going, and there Levinas was central, very important, constantly being debated.
But you're not telling everything. You're not telling everything because you're not telling her you were a Hegelian.
I was going to get to that. I was a convinced, I don't want to use the word dogmatic, but I was a convinced Hegelian. I was a convinced Hegelian. I thought that, and I was constantly seeking to bend the text of Hegel in order to show that in Hegel, it's not only that the other has its place, but that, in fact, I was flirting with the idea that in Hegel, the other is, in truth, primary to the same, to identity. That the other was first and foremost. In a sort of Levinasian perversion of Hegel without having read Levinas.
Ooh.
And so we had debates on this, very heated discussions, Raphael and I, on the place of the other, the place of Judaism, the place of otherness, alterity in Hegel. And I took the defense, in a way, the position of Hegel, and Raphael was taking the contrary, because we would often have dialectical arguments, but the other position, the position of the other, the place of the other in this debate. Yeah. So all this to say that there was the preoccupation with otherness, the preoccupation with the Jewish figure, or the Jew as other, had accompanied us since we were at the very beginning of our studies in philosophy, right? And so we constantly searched and attempted to interpret what is the place of the other in German, and consequently, what is the place of the Jew in Kant, Fichte, Hegel, Schelling, eventually Kierkegaard, Nietzsche, and then, of course, much before the Schwarze Hefte, the place of Judaism, the Jew, in Heidegger.
But I want to, yes, maybe if I may, just add something that I think is very important. I think that quite early in this dialogue, this ongoing dialogue between us, and we spend, I must say, we were living at the Cité Universitaire, at the dormitories, and we would read together, days and nights. Mm. We would read together. We started reading together Kant Buch, Kant's in the phenomenological interpretation of the Kritik der reinen Vernunft.
Even Sein und Zeit.
We read Sein und Zeit together a few times.
We
would discuss.
I have to interrupt that because this is also a university, yes? And so there are students, yes? And so they will want to know something about this very French and very European habit of reading together. Mm. It is something that is sometimes the American student is very like an atom, all by themselves in their own cell. And they move, they have great friends and they have lots of company, but they don't work with a friend or together. What do you, can you say just a little word about how that works? What does it mean to read? If you can go back to the beginning of your friendship when you decided to do this, what is it to read together?
I think it's a very good question, because obviously we can only think it now retrospectively, and I think at the time there was a very simple, almost instinctive, spontaneous enthusiasm for a dialogue. But now I think we have spoke about it. I think after now we understand that what was difficult for us as students is the solitude, of philosophy, which is also good and important, and something that is probably very important for philosophy. You know, the dialogue between the reader and the text. But there was something in this solitude that we wanted to, I think, distance ourselves from. And I remember that we both don't have a real religious background or knowledge. I mean, a traditional knowledge in Jewish thinking. But I have experienced some reading in yeshiva, and maybe the thing I would take from the yeshiva today. Because politically, I feel extremely resistant, I would say, to the yeshivatic world. But one thing I would take is the dialogue in reading. Yes. That you see when you have a page of the Talmud open, you're always facing the other. And this is something that this hermeneutic tradition is something that we, in a way, wanted to reappropriate in the philosophical reading. I remember we were talking about it, and we were always saying that this is something great in the yeshiva, you see? So it's not political, it's not religious, it's not dogmatic in any way, but there is something in this way of reading and looking at each other whilst reading the text that we wanted, I remember we wanted to reinstore.
Yes, definitely. And I mean, yes, we are in a university, and of course we can only, I would strongly encourage students to read together, actually, and I think with one other person it works the best. I mean, if we're going to have a technique here, I think it works the best. Because when you listen to, because reading together, we would read, each taking our turn. So we would read one paragraph of Sein und Zeit, and then Raphael would read one paragraph, and then I would read the next, and we would end up reading the whole book. And what is important is that in the reading, there's also, obviously, you're listening to the other. You're listening, and you're listening to where the other, in his reading, slows down, goes quicker, reads quicker, or slows down, and that actually has a meaning. It has a meaning. When I remember very distinctly this experience, this almost phenomenological experience, of reading a text, and when Raphael would slow down his reading, I knew that here either he wouldn't agree, or he was questioning,
hesitant,
and it forces you to actually be very attentive to the other, always, to how the other reads, and
the question
to pick up where the other is hesitant and so you're already in a dialogue when you're reading. Yes.
And this was extremely, as you say, phenomenological.
Yeah.
In Hegel's theological writings.
Oh, for sure.
This is where the question of Judaity, Jewishness, became dramatic. Yeah. You see, there was something dramatic because I would look at Joseph and I would tell him, yeah, but look, Joseph, look at what's going on here about the other. I mean, yes. And you see, this is something I wanted to go back to, is that although when Joseph was saying, talking about the beginning of this dialogue, I think that very, very early, it was never about, and this would sound problematic for many people, and maybe more today in the Heideggerian context, which I'm sure we'll talk about, but it was never about simple refutation, refusal, rejection of these authors. Even when we were talking about almost our own identity, right? Which is, you know, our question, which is almost a very personal question, but we never wanted it to be a personal question. It was never when we were reading Hegel's theological writings, you know? I did my DEA on Hegel's theological writings.
Okay.
And it was never simply to condemn Hegel. We are always trying to deploy it in all its radicality, force.
Potentiality.
Yes, always.
Wow. One question which immediately comes, and that's probably a very... There's probably lots of chapters to that encounter and its development and the way that it flowered and obviously has continued to grow and with many fruits. One could wonder a little bit about the theology, though, because, you know, I mentioned just very casually, you know, the Master of Fine Arts program that you directed. I'm interested in, or head, I don't know the Hebrew term that's exact, so whatever the technical term is, you can, people can fill that in. But you also organize exhibits. So most recently you told me, I think we had that great conversation about Walter Benjamin's collection, and this is perhaps something that might come to New York, or that might, if we're lucky, we find someone to bring it and so on. This is a significant thing. But how do you combine that? I mean, how do you, when there was a huge discussion in Washington about religion, for both of you, there's a book that I understand, Joseph, you're finishing a big book on sacrifice and Hegel and the religious writings, also the theme on Heidegger. It's one of the most profound discussions of Heidegger's own very difficult religious writings. How do you bring that together? Maybe Bataille is the answer, but I don't know. But how do you bring that together with philosophy? How do you begin? How do you bring that? And I'm asking you because if you, every so often I do applied arts, and so it's a messy business, a different world. How do you do that? Can you do that? Maybe both of you are doing that in different ways, also with your connection in Köln, if I'm not mistaken, Joseph. So both of you can answer that question, but I'll begin with you. How do you talk about theological things? Because the average person who talks about theological things, to be polite, can be a little bit sententious, you know, like a Kierkegaardian on steroids. You know, sometimes it's hard to stop them if they get started. And yet, it's probably the biggest question for philosophy, is the question of the divine, the question of God. But then, when one makes it another question, which is the question of the other, and to Levinas and also Derrida, since you brought him the question at the end of his life, of Judaism, this is a very different relation, yes, to the book than the Kierkegaardian question, than the Protestant question, and we're at a Catholic university, a Jesuit question. So there's a wholly other issue, and you use the example of this hermeneutic, this, which I think is very true, By the way, I agree very much this idea of the yeshiva method, which I think is at the basis of certain approaches to law, but also obviously this discussion that you were having. And yet, where does art come in then? So this is the tension to me.
So many questions.
That's just one. How do you put art and religion together?
Art and religion together.
Or your new deities, or your other, or your trajectory and the things that you've done. How do you manage to be yourself also very artistic people, both of you? That's a it's many questions, but it's one question.
Yes. Where do I start? I must say that I never felt any separation between my understanding of philosophy, I know this might sound very weird, and what we call art.
Okay.
This was something I kept telling my students also, my art students. For me, philosophy was never about theory, the concept, and art about, you know, something else. Sensibility, sensitivity, the body. I never felt this separation. I never thought in these terms. It was always very easy for me to engage in a dialogue with artists. As a teacher in Bezalel, which as you know is an art school, I did some studio work. I was working in the studio with the artists, with painters, sculptors, video installation type of artists. There was never, from my side, right? There was never this. I come from theory. My background is theoretical, and philosophy is a sort of illustration of what you do. For me, I almost felt that the Nietzschean idea since the beginning of doing philosophy as artists, or practicing philosophy as an artist would have or would do. This was always something very, very central to me. And I must say that this last curator project I did on Walter Benjamin. I did with another curator. Her name is Noam Segal, which I have to mention. This project also wanted when we thought of bringing together Walter Benjamin's archives. We were not looking for artworks. And I think this might explain a little better the situation you were talking about. We were never looking for artworks that would illustrate Walter Benjamin's theory. It was never about that. It was always in some ways. So we exposed in this show, in this exhibition, Walter Benjamin's archives, who are in Berlin, alongside, not side by side, but alongside, within contemporary artworks that we thought, in many ways, drift from Walter Benjamin's archives. Meaning that it was never about artworks that were illustrating or showing or exposing Walter Benjamin's concepts. So the Walter Benjamin's archives and the artworks were in some ways provoking each other, bringing them to show themselves differently, to express themselves differently. The archives appear outside the archival, the archaeological framework they are installed in, near the artworks, and vice versa. So you see, in a way, I must say, I know about the tension. I know about the tension between philosophy and theology, art and philosophy, but it's not something that I mean, there comes a point where what is happening in between these regions has to disappear. Okay. I don't know if I answer.
Well, no, you opened up questions, and that's what a good answer really does, is open up other questions. And there the question is, and I would offer, or at least look to Joseph, because I think there's a similar question that could also be posed even within philosophy. Even if you didn't go outside of philosophy, there are tensions in the things that you do, which are surprising to some people.
I think I'm going to get back to the question of God, because that's a massive question, and it's a great question, because you know, as Raphael was talking about the Walter Benjamin exhibition that he presented at the Tel Aviv Museum with Noam Segal, and this constant and incessant tension, with the relationship between truth, art, and justice. This is another project that we've been working on. So the question was, I was just rethinking about how we were trying to deploy those three ideas or those three orientations. And it's true, art was always, where are we going to put art? Between truth and justice, where are we gonna fit art? You know, art was always this type of supplement, and this comes out very much in the Walter Benjamin correspondence and exhibition that he did. But I want to get back to the question of God, because since we're talking about supplements, I think that's a massive question, and Raphael has already opened the door towards it. I mean, it's God. He's a strange companion to have, isn't he? He's a strange companion, but in a certain manner, in philosophy, he was an inevitable companion. Inevitable companion, and in this sense, because the very logic or logos of revelation just invited itself within philosophical discourse, just entered into philosophical discourse and said, listen, you can talk about logos, legain, reason, but there is this other type of logos, the logos of, which is not a logos precisely, this revelation, this very idea of revelation. And, well, philosophy has to deal with that, has to deal with this other, always on the question of the other, this other logic that has nothing to do with logic, that is other than logic, but still has that is still an inevitable modality of thinking, because, and here this is also something that we could talk about with the question of art, because it marks inevitably the tension, which I think Raphael and I are wholly inhabited by this tension between the irrepresentable and the representable. This tension, it seems to us, a major tension within the entire history of philosophy. A philosopher is always confronted, yes, with the question of God, but that means with the tension between the irrepresentable and the representable. In which manner, according to which law, can we represent that which escapes immediate representation? That's already the question. That's already approaching the question of God. It's already approaching the question of God. It's already approaching the very question of thinking, the very question of how does one set off in this project of thinking.
You're moving back to Heidegger, which I like, but I couldn't help, because one of the big temptations when I have a chance to introduce the two of you, for me, is always just to skip everything and say, well, you know, these are among the last, perhaps the last students of Derrida. And Jacques Derrida's own effort to represent the unrepresentable also falls squarely in the same question, because this is also after Nietzsche. So if Nietzsche is the one who sets the question of God, which is always God, man, and the universe is philosophy, that's the old-fashioned school way of talking about philosophy. But after Nietzsche, God moves out, but it's not just Nietzsche, there's the Vienna Circle, there's logical, there's a lot of fellow players. But Nietzsche is associated with the death of God, the thinking of the death of
Definitely.
God. And Derrida is the one also who thinks this through, thinks these, just this question, and Heidegger too, but maybe Derrida more painfully, more viscerally, more real. And the reason I'm tempted to just say the students of Derrida is because I see a continuation of Derrida in some of the things that you do, the spirit that goes and continues. Not that you are epigons at all, that no one could say that, but that there is a spark. And that there is something that still continues, and you're dealing with the most difficult of questions, and yet there's still that strange, that's a specter too, question of how is God today in our world today? So much is done now in his name, in the name of God, whatever that would be. This is from ISIS to you know, various fundamentalist groups in the United States, and what is this? You're raising a question of the mystery and of and in a Jesuit school we can say personal God, that's language we have no trouble using, but I have no idea, really, and you seem to indicate that that's still a mystery, that what that means is difficult to say. But what about Nietzsche? Because Nietzsche seems present too in some of your work, and Nietzsche seems to have a place, and yet he is not a friendly traveler with you. He's not a buddy. He's maybe a thorn. I don't know. I mean, I'm not sure. Is he? He was son of a preacher, so I think it's not too far from
Nietzsche is very, very present, and more, I must say. And also in our reading of Derrida and Levinas, we see them as even Levinas, we always say that Levinas is a very, very big Nietzsche reader. But you see, I mean, maybe to just to say a few words to continue what Joseph was saying, and I think that it's very much related to your question. It's never about rehabilitating God.
No.
I mean, for us. It's never about that. It's never about reinstoring theology. It would be quite complicated if we were to be very honest to say where is our interest in this question, and why we've been so interested in these theological or semi-theological questions, or what some people would consider to be not even philosophy, question of sacrifice, or the question of election.
Right.
For myself, this is a
question of forgiveness.
You gave a lovely lecture on election, did you not, on the question of choice here at Fordham some time ago, and had a great impact on the students at the time, as I recall. So that is a theme for you. Have you published anything coming from that, if I may ask?
I'm publishing now something. I've also published an article at
the International Journal of Philosophical Studies.
Yeah, that's a Dublin publication, right?
Absolutely.
A University College Dublin publication. So these questions are extremely important and interesting for us. Maybe mainly because we see them as embodied in the history of philosophy. Maybe mainly because it's very difficult to separate philosophy from theology, because the question of sacrifice, the question of forgiveness, the question of election, in many ways, maybe a little less the question of, it's less obvious for the question of election, but if you take these two questions, the one of forgiveness and the one of sacrifice, they are, in many ways, they structure philosophical discourse. You cannot definitely or completely separate philosophy from theology in that sense. And I think that our way of re-questioning, with all due modesty, our way of questioning sacrifice or forgiveness is always in the search of something, a notion of sacrifice of or of forgiveness that is beyond both philosophy and theology, or philosophy in the traditional sense of the word philosophy, which is
ontotheological. I think, yeah, and I think Raphael said it markedly. There is absolutely no temptation of rehabilitation of God in whatever we're seeking to think, right? But the question that you raise about the relationship to Derrida, yes, Derrida was our teacher, and we were very close to Derrida, but the relationship between Derrida and Nietzsche, for us, and consequently the question of nihilism, and Heidegger is right in the center of that. Heidegger is really right in the center of that, because if there is something between Nietzsche and Derrida, there is the massif of Heidegger, and Heidegger is one of the thinkers that really put on the table the question of European nihilism like no other after Nietzsche. So, but this question of nihilism, and Raphael spoke of the relationship between theology and philosophy, this question of nihilism for us is the central question of contemporary continental, as we say, philosophy.
As we say here.
In the English-speaking world. But the contemporary continental philosophy. The question of nihilism is a central interrogation that we must have, that it is urgent for us to have, because it is obviously not only a philosophical or slash theological question, but it's also a political question. Yeah. It's an economical question. Today it's in Europe, but also here, I'm sure, the advent and the presence and the over-presence of the nihilism of our Western society is palpable in every sphere of society, whether it be academia or whether it be the private sphere. So for us, the three authors in this constellation are Nietzsche, Derrida, and Heidegger. But to go back to your question, one of where you may see this spark of Derrida in our attempt to philosophize or to think our current epoch is to deploy as much as possible what we're trying to mark as a positivity of deconstruction. Far too long has deconstruction been associated with a simple negative impossibilizing modality of thought. What we are seeking to think from this is a positivity that is not about affirmation, simple affirmation of yet another value. And here's the question of nihilism, because here's the centrality of the question of nihilism. But another modality of thinking which would entirely confront the negativity of nihilism, but which would carry thinking into another way of responding responsibly to an actual situation, our actual situation. Emanating from deconstruction with an idea of justice that is irreducible to truth, that is irreducible to the modality of truth, the history of truth, which, according to our reading of the tradition, taken right out of Heidegger and Nietzsche, is entirely and incessantly worked by nihilism.
So maybe to put it in Nietzschean words, is if Nietzsche said that, we have, you would give me the exact translation, English translation, we have art not to perish from truth.
Yes.
We would say that we have art and justice in many ways not to perish from truth. And this is a true question very much related to nihilism, or our way of understanding nihilism, is what is it that kills, makes us perish in truth? So the true difficulty in what Joseph has just started approaching is how to approach, how to elaborate, how to start elaborating or thinking of a notion of justice that is not reducible to a norm, to normative thinking, or even to a simple institution of a norm. So it is justice that is also in many ways different or other than the institution of a norm. As you can imagine, it's quite difficult. It's quite difficult.
Is this a, for Nietzsche, of course, justice is, he says, that it is only as an aesthetic justification, aesthetische Rechtfertigung. And the very hard to translate that as justice, but we do. And that really means, as the word in German gives us, it's this making right. That this is, which is very, very much, he likes to speak of this kind of thing as the work of bridge builders, namely those who square an edge and bring it off so that it is now in measure and in line. This idea of justice is very different from the idea of a decay. This is not the same as a Greek idea, as you will see this in Anaximander, because in Anaximander it is a different kind of balance for encroachment. You have encroached, and whether you like it or not, it will be rectified, and the rectification is done in the order of time, just so. You will no longer encroach, you will perish. There seems to be another, if I'm hearing you rightly, understanding of justice, and I'd like to draw you out to talk just a little more about the way, because it's a very interesting way, it's maybe not Nietzsche's way of understanding justice, this Rechtfertigung, which is a little more upright, you know, it's, but there's maybe something else in this justice that you are looking to in your discussions of justice. A very intriguing question.
I think you're right. Reflection. Do you want to try something?
I mean, Raphael will talk about this because of the relationship also to Benjamin. But yes. I think the concept of justice that we're seeking to think is irreducible to right, is irreducible to Recht. And it's because justice is not only about getting it right. It's not only about getting it right. It's only about finding the proper justification in order to reestablish an order into a right order. That would be justice as it is linked into some kind of idea of truth.
Yes.
But what we're... Norm, or a value, of which we see even today. And I'm sorry to go on about... I wasn't expecting it, but I'm sorry to go on about our contemporary situation, but even today we see everything that we try politically, economically, sociologically, anthropologically, try to make right only aggravates the dysfunctioning of our what is left of our system. Yeah.
This is an extremely
troubling moment,
troubling situation, extremely complex situation. Every affirmation, every assertion entraîne
carries forth
or entraîner, yes, carries maybe, carries forth, as Joseph says, immediately the opposed, the contrary value, decision,
situation,
assertion, situation. There is a sort of feeling of, I think, and this is something probably Nietzsche here is very central for this understanding. It's as if each time you advance a philosophical assertion, you feel that there is something unilateral, almost ridicule. And this is nihilism, as you know. This is the nihilistic situation. So we understand Derrida in this context. For us, Derrida, even though he hasn't written any systematic essays on the question of nihilism, for us, it was one of his main... he had a very, very deep understanding of this situation. We think that deconstruction cannot be understood outside of this context. And this is why the question of justice has become so important in his late writings, in his reading of Benjamin, or in Levinas with La vérité suppose la justice, truth supposes justice, where, as you know, he says, I subscribe to this proposition without any reserve. So we really, right now, making an effort to try to understand in this context, in this political context, in this geopolitical context of Europe, of the Western world, but not only. I mean, not only of the Western world, that doesn't mean any much more, that doesn't mean anything anymore for us to say the Western world. It is a phenomena. Nihilism is a phenomena that is not proper to the Western world or to Western rationality. In this context, of nihilism, we try to understand the irreducibility of justice to truth, to normative thinking, to value thinking, and to try also try to understand what this means for politics also, for thinking politically, responsibly.
Is this I have to ask, is this since I was indicating that there's one sense of justice for Nietzsche and one sense of justice and its more conventional understanding of justice, that would be the typical one that's closest to truth. But that's not Nietzsche's, of course, but it's a different one. Mm-hmm. Is this a Jewish understanding of justice? I have to ask. What would you say?
That's a very difficult question, but I think a just question. It's a just question. There is an idea. There are. How can I say? There is. It seems that this idea of justice could find, not does, but could find certain traits in a certain Judaism. I'm here thinking most particularly of Scholem's theses on justice, for example.
Okay.
You know? And so you can, I think there are, and Raphael and I have talked about this, but it's still something that we have to figure out in a way, but we've talked about this. So I think there are some traits that could be taken from Judaism. But in another sense and in another manner, I don't think it is entirely encapsulable,
yeah,
determinable as a Judaic form or definition of justice. And I think it has to do with this idea. I think it has to do with the idea that the concept of justice that we are seeking to deploy is entirely riveted, it seems to me, entirely riveted to the singularity of particular situations, particular and very existential situations. It is not a generalizable concept. It cannot be a generalizable concept. It is a concept that is constantly and incessantly in its redefinition. Because it's not a value, it's not a norm. It is rather incessantly involved and engaged in the process of its redefinition, of its reassertion, of its reinvention. Yeah. So I'm not so sure that we can call it anything, this idea of justice.
But that's very Jewish. I mean, the idea of non-representability.
Yeah.
Is that? I mean, I am thinking of Jacob Taubes, who would go to Paris at the end of his life to visit Derrida, and they were talking for a certain amount, according to Jacob, to Taubes, about justice. Mm. So they were talking about maybe the unrepresentable that is not codifiable, not resolvable in this way, and always to be worked out, be in a case decided.
But the idea I'm most attached to is this idea of the unnameable,
yes,
the unnameability of it,
okay,
the unnameability and the incessant reformulation of that unnameability.
Yes.
It's not a static unnameability. It's not a heterogeneous unnameability. It's a constantly redefining unnameability of itself. That's just. Well, I think
that would be closer.
That would be something. If you can, when you look at someone, and you are incessantly, constantly, persistently looking at the other, where the other is in a certain manner never other, but always othering its otherness, then I think you're approaching being just to the other, because you're never determining that other even as another. You're constantly and incessantly you're constantly and incessantly opening to this othering of the other, that the other is always and will always be other, even to itself. I think that's approaching the question of justice.
That's a huge way that we've wound up solving that problem of justice would be excessive for us. But I love the definition that you're giving as this approximation,
it's
as if it were asymptotic and you came along to it and maybe always with a reticence, recognizing that you were at a distance, and needed to keep attuned to the other. We will run out of time if we're not careful. So I wanted to see if we could move the, not that that's really possible, but just to move it a little bit, maybe we're already on the theme of justice, we move it a little bit to what we've been talking about, which is the Heidelberg Project. I mean, this is a very, more than philosophy, as I understand, and both of you are involved with this Excellence Project.
Yes,
I love the name, Excellence Cluster. I just hear the word excellence and I stop there and forget the cluster. But this involves this is interdisciplinary by definition,
yes.
And you designed it to be this way. Can you tell us more about it for because this will, when does this begin? Is it beginning now?
It began.
Okay. So it's in train already. It is in process. Okay.
It's in process.
Excellent.
It's happening, and it's in Heidelberg, and it's a lot about interdisciplinary dialogue, bringing together people from all different preoccupations, from anthropology to history, and to discuss all these different notions of justice, Asian, Muslim, Buddhist, as you can imagine, this is extremely interesting for us. We are trained really in classical philosophy.
Yes.
We have some culture of Judaism, as you said and you mentioned, but it is so interesting for us to listen week after week to people coming from different backgrounds, and to really see the specificity of justice in each discourse. I think this is the project now. We have our own project.
You have things in addition to this that you yourselves are developing, and not only just in terms of the larger overarching project.
Exactly.
Can you tell us about that? We are
writing this book together now on truth and justice, on justice and truth, on this very, very complicated relationship. I'm always fascinated about the way he explains it. I mean, I don't know how he does that. You, Joseph. I mean,
Joseph,
I don't know.
He has that quality.
It's incredible because, you see, I mean, for me, this question of singularity and universality that he just started explaining is extremely difficult to explain in this context. You see, obviously, we think about this tension between singularity and universality all the time. We're trying, this is where maybe the Jewish inspiration is the strongest, although we really try to avoid calling this Jewish thinking or Jewish philosophy. The dialogue between certain conception of Judaity or Jewishness and Western philosophy is extremely central for us, is extremely important for us. And we also think that it is in all these places where certain conception of Judaism is, I would say, rejected or troubling the tradition of philosophy. This is where it becomes interesting for us. But to have a Jewish assertion or a Jewish affirmation is not something we would like to do. Mm-hmm. We would not like to advance a so-called Jewish thesis on justice. Okay. I think that this is something we like to work in the tension. We are looking for the tension. We are looking for all these places in the tradition, in Kant, in Hegel, in Schelling, very different from Kant and Hegel, as you know, in Fichte, extraordinary Schelling, yes? In Heidegger, more recently, where the question of singularity, the question of irrepresentability, the question of the unnameable, as Joseph said, where all these places are troubling, where they trouble the philosophical logos. This is where it becomes interesting for us. And this is maybe also the place where we are, again, with all due modesty, we are trying to think a different reading of the history of philosophy from a so-called, I would never say that in a book, never, Jewish perspective. I think we would never say that in these terms in a book. We would never say we have a Jewish perspective on the history of philosophy. There is something like that. There is something in this unusual, extraordinary other status of the Jew, Jewishness, revelation, election, and how these concepts, how can they provoke thinking? How can they open up to another notion of universality? Because, as Joseph said, there's no generalizable concept for what we are trying to think. But I think we have never given up, and we will never give up on the universal. So, in what way, in what manner, a thinking of singularity, because this is a notion that is very present in Judaism, let's put it in these words, in what way does singularity, a Jewish-inspired notion of singularity, opens up to a universal, a universality for all of us, and in relation to the question of justice? This is very, very important for us. So I don't know if I make myself clear.
Definitely, and I think what the one of the important points that you raise is this question of justice and this redefinition of this relationship between the singular and the universal. Yes. I mean, obviously there are plenty of situations, and our contemporary situation is one of these situations where we are confronting this type of redefinition. But if we bring it back to the history of philosophy and to the manner in which we were speaking about reading before, about the manner in which we read the history of philosophy, to remain just with the history of philosophy is one of the most important concerns and worries that Raphael and I. To remain just, even with this Heidegger affair, this new Heidegger affair, this Heidegger and the Jews conference that we did in Paris last year, to remain just, that is to constantly and incessantly see in the authors that we read, and Heidegger is an author that we read and that we must read, not because he was a great philosopher, he was, but because Heidegger is a part of our tradition. We carry him, whether we want it or not. Whether we reject him completely or not, we carry him. We cannot not carry him. Yeah? So, and to be just with what we carry has constantly been a concern. It doesn't stop us from asking all the critical questions, and God knows there are questions to be asked about this Heidegger affair. And it does not stop us from asking all the critical questions, does not stop us from affirming all the reservations that we must affirm in relation to Heidegger, but also in relation to any author in the tradition. Any author, from Kant, from Hegel, to Nietzsche, all the authors in the tradition, we must have the right, that is, the justice, much more than the right, the justice to affirm our reservations.
And I want to say something a little personal also. I think we're paying a certain price for this.
Yes.
We have been accused in the last year and a half,
yes,
of all the most incredible things because we maintain a certain, the one that Joseph just described, attachment to reading Heidegger and to reading all the other big, important philosophers of our tradition. This is our tradition. You cannot just decide to depart yourself from this tradition. You cannot just decide to not read anymore because he says this or that, the most terrible things, we agree and we know that, about the Jews or others. It doesn't really matter here. I mean, it does matter because, I didn't mean that what he says about the Jews doesn't matter. But this is very important, and that's what we're trying to understand. What is he saying specifically about the Jews? And this
that's
is
right.
very important
that's
to understand
right.
what he's saying specifically about
yes.
the Jews. And we are in Europe, and we are in Europe of the 30s and 40s, and this is very important, and this is, we are talking in a very specific context, and this is what we have to understand. This is what we have to read. This is the tradition we have to read, and to go on reading, and rereading, and to we will probably have to read it in 50 years, and in 100 years, and 150 years, because the question of the Shoah is not a question that will end with the passing of time, because Europe is still very much under the building of Europe, the reconstruction of Europe, the crumbling down of Europe, the crisis in Europe is to be understood also in rapport to the 20th century and the 40s and the Shoah. So never abandon.
Yeah, and when Raphael speaks about we've been accused, I think it's important to say, because anybody that does serious work, and of course you know this better than any, Babette, to do serious work interpreting Heidegger or interpreting Hegel, or when Raphael interprets Kant in relationship to Judaism in the book that you mentioned, there is a necessity in order to understand anything about what these authors are saying about, here in this case, the Jews. There is a necessity to enter into, and I believe very strongly in this, to enter into the writing of the philosopher or author you are explicating. To enter within his writing. It's not an easy task to enter and almost espouse this writing. And this is often characterized, and it has been, we've been attacked on this, as a sort of fascination. It has, again, it has nothing to do with a fascination, because it does have something to do with the I would say ethical responsibility, mm-hmm, not only of the interpreter in regards to a work, but also in regards to what that work leaves unthought, or what that work leaves as an unthinkable. And I think that if you follow this method of hermeneutics, you will see in the case of Heidegger. This is the thesis that we developed in Washington just last week, that that Judaism for Heidegger is an unthinkable, Heidegger, not an unthought.
Heidegger can't think it, you think.
Heidegger can't think it. You can only think that if you enter fully and entirely into what Heidegger thinks. And it's not fascination. On the contrary, it's an ethical responsibility.
I would like to add something here, if I may. There are many people mm-hmm. that think that they could resolve this question by saying that it is Heidegger's destruction of the subject, of the responsible moral sovereign subject, that leads to his, let's call it, anti-Judaism. They think that they could resolve this question, this extremely difficult and abyssal question, which we take very seriously. They think that they could just resolve this question by saying that this is Heidegger's destitution of the subject, of subjectivity that leads to anti-Judaism or to his acquaintance with fascism. And we just won't accept that. It is impossible. This is not serious. This is not serious. This is not science. This is not hermeneutics. This is not philosophy. You cannot just resolve this tension with, Heidegger drops ethics. What does that mean? We know of people that, of thoughts, of philosophies that drop ethics and that are extremely just. Maybe a certain conception of radical justice as we try to approach it means in some ways to distance yourself from ethics. As far as we're concerned, Levinas is not really an ethical thinker. He's not a thinker of ethics. The incessant search that Levinas and that Joseph was talking about, that Levinas was conducting this research of this other, of the alterity of the other, means that there comes a moment, and he says that, where he drops ethics. Because you know you cannot just substantialize the other in ethical thinking. You would have to depart yourself also from ethical thinking. Mm. Wow. So yes, there is also maybe this little personal note. Maybe we got too personal. I don't know. But there was this personal note. I think that was important for us because. These attacks were, I must say, pretty violent and unjust.
But I'm sorry, Babette, but I just wanted to say, please. Just on the continuation of what Raphael is saying, about, you know, this Heidegger affair, it's very strange because a lot of people think either, oh, yet another Heidegger affair, well, now it's time to get entirely rid of Heidegger, because this is the affair of all affairs, and that's it. But this affair of all affairs is precisely the reason why we cannot afford to separate ourselves from reading Heidegger and our philosophical tradition under the prism, through the renewed prism, let's say, of this attention, this just attention towards otherness and towards anti-Judaism. Because this affair of all affairs, this affair of all affairs in Heidegger, if we get rid of it simply by saying we'll sweep it under the carpet, it is almost a historical necessity that it will come back as a specter and hit us back in the face in very little time, in a very short time. We can't, as a return of the refoulé, you know, and we can't afford this. Our thinking, our philosophical thinking, cannot afford to simply treat its tradition as if we were sifting it away from all that this tradition has of problematic. We must confront the problematicity at its most heightened form, because our present and consequently our future depends on it.
See, I agree with you completely. The worry that I have is maybe, this is the French version of Peter Tvapany. The English version looks like this. I think the French version is cuter. Somehow it's different, myth of a world conspiracy, and this gets it front and center, Heidegger and anti-Semitism. Talk about different translations. Where does he go? Where is the future for Heidegger? What are appointments in universities looking like? I have real continental thinkers, young people here, and this is the future of philosophy, but I always have a worry. What will that really look like at the end of the day? What are the universities doing? I do agree with you, but then I think, is this not the kind of least excuse that's needed to jettison an entire tradition and maybe replace it with an easier philosophy, something that fits more easily into information studies or a cognitive science or something else like that, but that doesn't make any trouble and doesn't make us have to think? Because what you say is profoundly disturbing, challenging, makes one have to re-examine even what one thinks one knew ethics to be, or justice to be, or even what saying that something might perhaps be a tradition from Judaism in addition to other traditions, Greek, Athens, Jerusalem, very complicated, all things up for grabs, still to be thought. But then there is our, what Nietzsche called the future of our educational institutions. What are those going to look like? You have this excellence cluster, may you be able to make wonderful things from it, but I having you here, I wonder how you feel. This is a terrible last question, but I have no time for more questions, but I can't let it go without raising it. What, for the two of you, is your sense of this? I mean, this is a very valiant, and justice is part of being valiant, being brave, stand to take. But what do you see as possibilities for the new future? And France is the future. I mean, it's only Francophone philosophy that is always the cutting edge, you know, Derrida, and now what? And then we cast about for heirs. We cast about for the next and the possibilities. But then to do that, there have to be positions, and there have to be jobs, and there have to be recognition, and there have to be translations, and you've done massive service on your own parts, but how do you feel yourselves at this point? What can you tell us as we look to the continent and we are interested, what's France or what's Germany? And you're nicely positioned to answer both questions. So it's a bad last question, but it's an irresistible last question. So.
Well, it's a very difficult question. I must, to be very, very honest, I think that you've asked me in the beginning about my teaching in an art school.
Yes, I did.
I mean, I'm in an art school because I think that probably for Israeli university, which is very much influenced by, I mean, very much, totally influenced by Anglo-Saxon analytical tradition, which myself, I respect very much, and this is very important to say. I think we both
definitely
are extremely respectful of this tradition. So my own situation is extremely complicated. I never got a decent job in a university, and I think this is mainly because I'm associated to Derrida and to a certain Heidegger.
That's right.
And to Hegel and to all the others and to Nietzsche. And what is happening now with the Heidegger affair of all affairs, as Joseph has just named it, is just a pretext, another pretext to reject this whole tradition, with the tradition as a whole. The only thing I can say, I mean, at my age now, I mean, I'm not that young anymore, and I'm very serious. I mean, I'm not that young.
Permit me to laugh. But
in terms of my philosophical career and what will happen with my career and where will I be teaching in the next few years, in these terms, I'm not that young, in the sense. The only thing I can say is that, and that something we talk about all the time, is that we have decided just to continue working, insisting on almost obsessively on philosophy, on working, on reading the texts, trying to reinterpret them, redeploy them again and again, incessantly, as Joseph says. This is the only thing I can say for now. I mean, I don't know what will happen. Somewhere, I believe, that might be quite naive, but somewhere, somebody in me believes that if we do this work properly, there will be a change.
Yes.
That's great. That's a great answer. I would have trouble following up on it, but I think we were facing, and you're in Washington at the APA, you gave a talk, a lecture, about precisely about this subject matter, and we are facing a danger today, which is not we are philosophy. Whether it's mostly the continental. But let's not think also that the analytic are so outside this danger, because if philosophy goes, philosophy is going to go. and because the scientists will not really care about what the philosophers of science are really questioning. Yeah? So we are facing a danger which is not dissociable from the question of nihilism that we started. I mean, nihilism has affected academia, and as Raphael said, to continue this work. And I think we can make a plea here to expect and demand of our academic institutions. I would even go so far as to say also of our political institutions, to expect and demand the multiplicity. We talked about singularity, but the multiplicity of modalities of thinking is a responsibility that us as academics must incessantly claim and reclaim. To claim and reclaim the demand of multiplicity of approaches to questions that we need to address.
More than one approach.
More than one approach. We are even ourselves structured by the more than one. I have more than one language in me. You have more than one language. Raphael has more than one language in me. The language I speak is also more than one language. So why not? Why are we seeing today this descent, this reduction of our academic institutions into one type of one type of rationality, one type of technologically framed rationality. Why are we seeing this dérive, the word that Raphael used, this dérive, this descent, this type of, why are we seeing this? Is this the history of our humanity? Is the history of our humanity culminating into this movement to the affirmation of one rationality? Should we not be seeing at the point we are, and with the history we have, should we not be seeing, on the contrary, and in academic institutions most particularly, the dissemination, the multiplication of approaches to questions that we need to look at anyhow?
And not only in cluster of excellences, in the academia.
Only in clusters of excellence.
I have to bring this to an end, but I also want to say, having been to Paris and having seen what you did there that resulted in Heidegger et les Juifs, this very, very large book, I show it again because why not, it's a book. But your, both of you, in your comportment at that conference, in my mind, and the mind of many others, was exemplary of this kind of openness and this kind of fairness. I would have to say, as a kind of, I follow some of this, that what you did there was exceptional, unique, among many of the other conferences, in bringing not simply only des petits copains, you know, but des petits camarades, but also and serious, what philosophy has always done, the real dialectic, the dialogue, the with the exchange, with respect and honoring even differences with which I am sure you did not agree, but allowing for that possibility. So it is one thing to talk that talk. Mm. I saw that you did this. This is something I admired immensely. And I think, what is it that Heidegger likes to quote from Kant, which is a good thing to quote, if something is actual, if it was ever done and you did it, it's possible. So since it can be done, because it has been done, maybe we should aspire to that in the future if we can. Joseph Cohen, Raphael Zagury-Orly, I am very, very grateful that you came and talked today.
Thank you so much.
I appreciate that. Thank you again for your presence and your time. Fordham University is also grateful for your being here, and I thank you for your attention.